Chibuku.
Like a bucket.
My nature, I criticize on social media. Yeah, I think I'm good at that when it comes to social media. That's why I really like spending most of my time in social media.
Kulirwenywa kunjageyo. Namba sina sente ntulali. Nendoza.
Today we are going to discuss a very confusing topic, but I understand, however much it's confusing, but we want the people to understand, also other stakeholders to understand. We're going to discuss the topic, which is what drives young people to engage themselves into sexual activities when they are still young or at an early age. We have brought different people on the panel. Remember, this discussion is hosted by Mubiru Sam and also powered by the Good Faith Network. And we are hosted at China Uganda French Hospital with different services. We have brought Mzila Tone on my hand, right hand side. He's an advocate, speaks for young people. And you also have how do we pronounce that?
Deborah Vashti.
He's a counselor by professional. We have Mr. Sempala Joachim, a teacher by professional. Teacher at St. Chizito Secondary School, then also Boyogere High, Shindayo branch. And the topic is what drives young people to engage themselves into sexual activities. Before we go further, I don't know if I've introduced everyone's name very right and they are professionals. I'm going to start from Mr. Sempala Joachim. You can introduce yourself briefly before we proceed.
Hello viewers, my name is Sempala Joachim. I want to collect him. He said scientist to SS, but should be scientist to high school in Congo. Teacher by profession, I'm delighted and honored to be here.
Thank you, Mr. Sempala. Yes, Deborah.
Thank you, Sam, for this opportunity. I'm Deborah Vashti. I'm an HIV AIDS counselor in particular, but I'm a counselor at large. Mm-hmm. Yes, I work at Teenage Center.
Tony Muzira, an advocate.
Yes, good afternoon, our viewers. First of all, I'm so happy to be here, giving me an opportunity to speak for the voiceless. My name is Tony Muzira Johnson. I'm a sexual productive health and rights advocate, as well as people need to know. I'm a business person as well, that is my profession.
Sure. Okay. Then we are going to open the topic. It's going to be an open discussion. However, we are going to be throwing questions to very, very many people. And remember, also, you is on Facebook. You can easily drop your comments and also your reaction about the topic. Before we go further, what age do you think that young people should engage themselves into sexual activities? I'm going to begin from my right-hand side, from Mr. Mzila Tony. What age do you think young people should engage themselves into sexual activities?
First of all, the whole issue that we are talking about, what drives these young people, that is the first question which will give you the answer to what age.
Mm.
As a country, we have so many challenges as far as to policy.
Mm.
And we have been having discussions with the government, Ministry of Health, and their main challenge was about why is it that young people below the age of 16 are having sex. And they think that for us who are giving them information, we are the ones encouraging them to have sex. But however, there are a number of challenges that drive them to have sex. To answer your question, Sam, I've just given you a snapshot of what causes all that.
Mm.
To me, I think as long as a young person has got the right information, right from the age zero, when the child has just been born, as a parent, speak out to these kids and tell them these issues about sex. Don't wait for them to go into puberty, go into high school, then you start talking about them. Because if you don't tell them as a parent, they will go out to a stranger who will give them wrong information. So to me, I won't say that they should have
the right age.
Yes, but as long as they have the right information, they will be able to make the right decision when to have sex and whom to have it with and when to have it.
Okay. Thank you very much. Yes. When it comes to Deborah, what age do you think young people should engage themselves into sexual activities.
Okay, thank you. Age, really, I don't think that age matters.
Mm.
One thing I remember, when we used to be young,
yeah,
we used to pray Mama Tat, you know?
I remember.
But by the time we pray Mama Tat, you know what happens between Mama and Tat? Meaning that the feeling has already
developed.
So, I would not think, but I know because I've been through it, I speak out of experience. We get those feelings as early as even, I think, around 5-6 years. Yeah. The feeling's there, but engaging in sexual activity, I think around 12-13, there is what they call adolescent age. It's a very strong age. Very, how should I say it? It sends someone. It's like a spirit that sends you.
Go and do it.
So there's no way you can control it. You know? So I think it is best if we also give those kids the information right from Mama Tata. If they know that Mama and Tata will play like this, will do like this. I say, age, really. I can't say much about it. So, apart from that.
Okay, let me cross over to a teacher. Mr. Simple, are you watching?
Yes, sir.
What age do you think young people should engage themselves into sexual activities?
That is a $1 million question.
Definitely.
Yeah, for sure, as a teacher, that has ever happened to my life, discussing with the students, refusing them to engage into sex at that other age, and their question was, at what is the right age? So let us define the word right. Right is something, if something is right, is appropriate, is perfectly okay, and fit for the purpose. Now, sexual activities for what purpose? It depends now to get to know, before we look at the age now. So this makes me to wonder, which is the right age? When is one appropriate to engage into sexual intercourse or sexual activities? So far. So then, there are a number of determinants. To a youth or to a student who is at secondary level, he will tell you that it's okay at any age. Then to a parent will tell you, no, my dear, you finished the academic sessions, you finish your university, you will be free to engage into sex. So to a parent, is academic fulfillment. To a student, for him, he looks at any other thing. Then, mark you, look at even the religion, at what age should these people engage into sex? Religiously, I will sample out our brothers, the Muslims. They will tell you that at one point, if a girl enters into a menstruation period, she's fit to be somebody's wife. Because an example is got from them, whereby they talk about their prophet. At the age of 9, he had booked Aisha. So if you book somebody at 9, it means now that person, the next year or 2 years, he will engage into, she may engage into sexual activities. Culturally, they will tell you, after initiation, to our brothers of East, they will tell you, once you are circumcised, you pass the initiation sessions, you are okay to test to engage into the activities. So the age becomes also a rightful age, is still uncertain. So it depends from which area.
Okay. But the law of Uganda says for somebody to engage him or herself into sexual activities should be 18 years and above. That's what the law says. 18 and above. To all Ugandans, if you are going to engage yourself in sexual activities, you are supposed to be 18 and above. And now, the other question is, what or is where these young people go to involve themselves in those sexual activities? For this one, I'm going to, first of all, let it go first of all to you, Deborah. What do you think that always drives these young people to engage themselves in those sexual activities? Because you have seen very many young people, like for you, a counselor, you have approached girls who have become pregnant when they are still young at an early age. You have approached girls whom you have tested and they are HIV positive. Not from their parents, but when they have involved themselves into sex. What do you think, what do they always tell that drives them to go into sexual activities?
Well, there are very many leads to it. but the most common so far, social media.
How?
Social media, as we speak now, a child, the moment they finish maybe primary 7, the teacher can testify to it. They are given mobile phones, they are given tablets, they are given every mechanical item that can enable them to access what they feel has driven them to it. So basically social media is
one of the leading cause.
The leading cause?
Is it one of the leading cause or is the leading cause?
It's the leading cause, not one of them, it's the leading cause.
Cause if you look at me, a person who is always on social media, if I go on social media, I could have gone there to post my photos or to engage myself with some other people, maybe friends.
Now that is also one other thing, peer group. It also leads to want to engage in social activities. The friend comes, for me, I broke my virginity, what about you? How was it? And then you attempt to be like, I think I should also do it, you know?
Sure.
It will not only come from the social media, but after social media, this one has also done it, and they'll come and share with you, the friend, and the whole thing goes on, and you're already engaged into the activity.
Okay. To a person, Mozilla Tony, who is always on social media, do you think social media is one of the leading causes of young people engaging themselves in the social activities?
Yes, I agree with
Deborah.
I don't know if she's from Uganda, but just to answer your question, yes. To me, social media is that I will not per se that it's the leading cause.
Mm-hmm.
Because when I look at, you know, we go to communities.
Yeah.
When you go to the village like in Bukuda or in Uganda where I come from, there are so many young people who don't have access to these phones.
That is not true.
Yes.
They have Rwanda.
Yeah, yes.
So
on social media,
yeah.
It has actually escalated a lot of, you know, a lot of misinformation about these issues.
Yes.
That's always amazing. Even at home. You know, we like WhatsApp. If you're at home, can you imagine a 5-year-old kid is able to access your phone, goes into your gallery and checks everything? So whenever a kid looks at maybe let's say those videos and all that, you won't know. So he or she will go and tell the friends or at school or something, hey, I was in mommy's phone, then I looked at this. So it actually escalated. It escalates a lot of tension within them. Just like, you know, the rat is always curious to know about the issue. Yeah. So they will do that. Secondly, also the TV programs also at a level. You've seen the government has come out saying that the way artists dress, drive these kids and all that, these music videos and all that. So that's why the government came out and they came up with a committee, the anti-pornography committee, and all that. Because of all that, what your child watches on TV also matters. That also drives me to talk about something on some channels, let's say the cartoons and all that. Yeah. The cartoons have been spoiled.
Right.
The way that even homosexuality has been embedded in
the cartoons?
Yes, yes. And I remember there was a time when the reason why the first lady came up with the sexual education framework was because of those things that were happening. And information came in that even some people started packaging it, the booklets.
They use for...
Exactly. So instead of giving getting the right information, to me, I take it back to the parents. I mean, how do you monitor your child at home? What does your child watch? You remember that time when you had that one maid infected a child with HIV positive? So, and that brought a debate of, like, if a maid is going to work in your home, should they be first tested for HIV?
Mm-hmm.
So also depends on the kind of environment people that live with these children, and also you as a parent, what role are you playing to make sure that your child gets the right information? Most cases, parents themselves being what happens at home is they don't know.
Mm.
They just come back, hey, how are you? Brenda,
yeah.
You know. But remember, a child, let me tell you, the most wisest person is a young child.
Sure.
Joachim can testify.
Let us shift gear to Mr. Joachim.
Yes.
And also this.
I just wanted to finish before you go to
that. Yeah.
I'm just finishing my point. A 5-year-old kid or 6 or even 3, they are very sharp.
Mm.
Very sharp. So they can keep something for even 10 years.
Definitely, yeah.
So that's for you, you want to know. That's why sometimes people say that kids of these days, actually they call them the first generation.
Mm.
They know even things that you don't know.
That's very
true. I'll stop there.
Thank you, Tony.
Yeah.
Let us shift gear to Mr. Joachim.
Yes.
You have been in teaching for so long and you have experience in this. What do you think that drives these young people or your students? Let me call them your students or your pupils to engage themselves into sexual activities.
Thank you very much. It's not even a single reason can come up with a justification for them engaging into sexual activities, but it's a combination of many factors. You have talked about social media, but social media is a branch of other media. For me, I would call it media. What has media done, especially the audiovisual media? Look at a case study on the opera soaps parents watch with parents, with their children, I mean. The only thing which children learn from social opera soaps is that kissing and pecking is okay, and handshake is for the old. So you see them, they try it out at home, under the supervision at times of the elders who think that is modernity. So that alone has costed the generation, that they think when you tell them that it's a handshake, for them they will look at a hug, they will look at a kiss, and a fake. That is normal. We see it on TV, people doing it. When somebody on TV is saying good night to the little one, we'll fake, we'll kiss, which becomes normal.
Yeah.
Then the question is, culturally, are we safe? We are not safe. Also, here is the Western influence has made us to learn the negativity, and we have dropped the positivity out of them. Secondly, to me, it's like culture. When I talk about culture, it's broad. In my first presentation, I told you about these who engage into initiation rites. Once you go into initiation, it's a transformation from childhood to adult. It means somebody is an adult, especially among our brothers from Mbale. They will tell you that once you are circumcised, now you are an adult. You need to get a partner. In fact, there's a school of thought that before healing, you have to test and to see. They give you that platform to engage into sexual activities. And nowadays, the age at which they circumcise is relatively not the rightful age. If a parent thinks that I have to fall into a context of maybe my son, he will not reach at the even year when he's old, he will be older. They take even children of 16, 15 to do it. So, and so also that can make them engage into that. Look at the engagement, peer influence. So for them, the youth or the students, yes, we have more time with them, but then they are off. We are going to receive them from the holidays. What have they been doing at home? Nowadays we have parents who act like mommies and daddies, not carrying out the responsibility of parenting. Parenting is for the teachers and educating. So we are teachers at school and parents. At home we have maids. What will they teach this little one who even disrespects them? Who can report to the boss, and the boss at the end of the day looks at the maid as a problem. So we need to combine effort to fight for this generation. For Indians, called it a first generation, but then for us, we refer to it as it like a first generation. A generation of technology, whereby they are too curious. There is that point of curiosity. Yes, they desire to discover more. Why are you denying me this? I need to know. So all that made many to engage into sexual activities.
Don't you think sometimes when you tell these young people not to test or not to do this, sometimes drives them to go and do that. When it goes to Deborah, when your parents told you, please Deborah, don't steal sugar. Sometimes we end up stealing sugar because they have told us not to steal sugar. We just attract, what's in that sugar they are telling them to steal? Do you think if your parent tells you not to do something, you end up doing it? Is it true?
It is not true.
It's not true, is it?
To some extent. it drives back to his statement, curiosity. But then I got challenged once. I got a young client of 12 years, 11, 12 years. He told me he was sent by the mother to test. He tested. The results came out. The next question was, so can I go out now and have sex, because I think I'm safe and the age is that, you know, because he was told he's eligible to what? To test. So meaning that maybe someone or a friend told them that when you test and you're safe and you reach 12 years, you can have sex. No, I had no answer to that.
Sure.
I was a bit confused. Like you said, it's a very confusing.
Then, still now to Mr. Tony. Do you think sometimes if somebody tells you not to do something, you end up doing it? So do we say the parents should not say, tell their parents to their kids to do anything? So if you see your kid doing something, you either encourage the kid to do it or you stop the kid from doing it, not to tell the kid don't do it. Because if you say don't do this, that means I'll also go ahead and do it.
Yeah, I'll talk about curiosity. Yeah. These kids, they always want to know. And they always keep knowing. But to me, I think is the approach matters a lot. You don't just come and tell me, Tony, don't do this, don't do this. You know, it matters. You know, like the way we were raised, and those the same way kids of these days are raised.
How were you raised? Then you can do it. Just do it within 2 minutes.
No, for us, we were raised by a stick. But now these days, the law is very clear. You're not supposed to beat kids.
Sure.
Yeah, you saw in videos the parent who, you know, who was caught beating up the child, and all, you saw what happened.
Mm. Was taken to court.
So the way you approach this kids, talk to them well, make them, first of all, parents are not friendly to their kids. You put on a gloomy face, your child fears to you, so we'll go out and look for her, who is very open to her, you know, and you know, you have to be very flexible how you're talking to these kids. So to answer your question is, to me I would say, it is the way you're telling these kids on what to do. You must have an approach that is mainly to them, to their generation. That's why we're even saying that as advocates, the policies should be as friendly. You know, to what age, how are we supposed to package information to a child who is below the age of 15? How are you supposed to give someone who is above 15 years? It matters because they have different needs. The way they think about it. So if you just come and say, you, get on as don't do this, trust me, this kid will go and do it. And also, actually, I'll just give you an example. I'll not speak out the name. There was a neighbor of ours. She, in 2013, she joined Makere. She was doing social sciences. But the father happened to be one of these big Muslim guys who sit at the Supreme Council, and it's very known. He comes, he brings her in the morning for lectures, he comes back in the evening and takes her home. So, and you know when these girls are going to campus, you know that campus life.
Yeah, yeah.
So the girls like, when I go to Fala now, we are going out, they are taking us to Cafe Java's and all of that. So you know what happened? Because of curiosity. She's always indoors, they don't allow her to go out. So what she did, she went out, got some guy, got her pregnant, and they asked her who was responsible. She said it was my dad. You know?
So after 1 month, that's when she came out and said, no, it wasn't my dad, but I just wanted to teach my father that I also have a right to do whatever I want. So you don't have to be hard on these children. Make them friendly and show them the world that whatever you do will affect you. The decisions you make will affect your future. So you don't have to be that hard on them. They will always have that curiosity to do those things.
That's very true. Before we go for a short break, when you come back, we are going to discuss on how parents of nowadays are raising their kids, and parents of those days used to raise their kids. How were people raised, and how are kids of nowadays raised? What killed the cat was curiosity. Is it true that curiosity killed the cat? We are going to be back with Mr. Semba Ajiwachi, my teacher by professional, Deborah, a counselor, and also Tony Muzila, an advocate.
Coming soon on social medias, it's S class.
Of Ziloko, my
so what level, like a bottle of chibuku?
Like a bucket.
It's my nature, I criticize on social media. Yeah, I think I'm good at that when it comes to social media. That's why I really like spending most of my time in social media.
Bulirenyu akunja geyo. Naemba sina sente, ntulali. Nendoza.
Coming soon on social media,
it's S. Break our dear viewers. Remember, you can easily follow our Facebook page, which is S Class. Then you also can follow us on YouTube, S Class 256. You can also follow us on Twitter, S Class 256, and also on Instagram, S Class 2. Remember, we are discussing the reason as what drives young people and get themselves into sexual activities. And before we went to a commercial break, we are discussing what drives these young people to get themselves into sexual activities. We first of all discuss what age should young people involve themselves into sexual activities. And remember, we have Tony Muzila, an advocate. We have Deborah, who is a counselor by professional also. Then we have also Mr. Zempala Joachim, a teacher by professional. Then our topic is, we are going to discuss parenting. What have parents done to stop their kids from engaging themselves into sexual activities? What are parents of those days, your parents, maybe my parents, what they did so that they always raise us in a proper way, that we don't engage ourselves into sexual activities? And what are the parents of nowadays doing, or what they have not done, what those parents need to do? When we are going to Mr. Zempala Joachim, what are the gaps that these parents of nowadays have not done, which parents of those days they did?
Yes, thank you very much. Parenting is a process of nurturing somebody. So it's a continuous aspect. You need to push on. Parents of today have ignored this aspect in life and left it for, most of them have ignored it and left it for their maids and teachers. Why do I bring out teachers? Because at times they are saying things we see in students, and you ask yourself, where they taught about this from home. Look at the way they eat food, the way they dress up, the way they wake up and start up the hour and start a day. So the number of challenges, parents of our time, they were parents, but today we have mommies and daddies who only come back late, sit on laptops or sit on the TV, watch the opera, soap around with the children, discuss matters, some matters of adulthood with their children. And they're exposing them to these things at an early stage. I keep on asking myself, why is this so? Don't we know that we need to give time to our children? Because this is a right now, they deserve time. Many parents don't know what their children do. But what they know is providing money for school fees, forcing them to go to school, even denying them a right to ask them, why am I going to school? Parents of today mind more on they don't mind the details, and children mind the details. They want to know why they are going to school and what they will benefit from them going to school. So our parents used a communal aspect. They could engage the community at large. Mm. You were a child of the community. Every person, every adult was eligible to impose a punishment if at all he had seen you doing something not accepted in the society. They could tell you that, yeah, you're moving astray. Come on the right track. What you're doing is wrong. Canes were the order of the day. I don't encourage parents to continuously cane, but also counseling. They were exemplary. Some parents today, they speak A and do B. When the community members try to look at the children, try to teach them what to do, parents now become the barrier. Why are you doing this to my child? So responsibility cuts across. We should engage, we should look at the communal aspect. Let the other neighbors, the immediate neighbor, be a parent to your child. Look at the environment we are living in. The I don't care syndrome. Many people don't care porn. The child next door. When you are caring to the child next door, somebody will impart something wrong upon you, that you have wrong intentions. Why are you caring so much about my child? Yet you're trying to at least organize this person into the right path. So we need to look at time. There's no way you say that you care about your child and you don't give that person time. You need to listen to them. Try to discover more what they can do. Encourage them. Okay? So I think we need to engage ourselves into, because all of us have to move into the right direction of nurturing. Mm. Not staying now in our places, not looking at teachers alone, but we as teachers, we used to learn from, like especially like me, we learn from the seniors. Mm. Now, to whom will the child learn to if the parent does not give the child time? And look at the maids at home. Age mates. Some of them are looked at by the children as failures of life.
Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Sempala. We have brought in an aspect of we no longer have parents, we have daddies and mummies.
Good.
Now you are coming to Deborah. Do you think parents of those days used to care more to their kids than parents of nowadays? And if so, what are parents of nowadays doing that those parents used not to do?
Thank you very much.
According to you, yes.
I would say, parents of those days, even if they did not have time with their children, we had uncles, we had aunties. A parent would say, this holiday you are going to your aunt, that is Amit. Then John, you are going to go to your uncle. You understand? Mm. But then, there is that information they will pass on to their uncles and aunties. The duty of what we are discussing, why, what is causing these children to get into sexual activities at that age. That was the duty of the uncles and the aunties. I don't think the parents had that courage, leave alone not having the time, but the parents had, they had no courage to say anything to their children. Which has even failed the parents of this 21st century. They have kept distances from their brothers and sisters. I speak out of experience because personally I learned most of the things from school. I had no auntie, I had no uncle. I'm not saying they were past. They were there, but I did not get to know them. My parents did not show me or even tell me that you have an aunt or an uncle. You get to know them on functions. And even if you know them, they do not give you time that, hey, my daughter, I'm called this and this. You should get time. Come and pay me a visit. Which is not there these days. Parents of these days have that challenge. So we need to let our children know their people who are even going to help them. But I also must say aunties also have no time for children anymore. Just like any other parents who we are complaining about that they don't have time for their children. So the great difference between the parents of those days and these days, they really used to care about their children. They gave them time. If they don't give them time, they send the duty to the uncle or the auntie.
Thank you so much. Yes, to go to Mzee Tony. Mr. Simpa talked about I don't care syndrome. And I believe that your parents used to care so much about you and used to guide you where you used to go wrong. What did your parents used to do that you see parents of your neighbors, the neighbors who are your parents, are not doing to take care of their kids or people in the community? Because I believe those days, like Simpa said, those days, a child used to belong to a whole community. If somebody finds when you are not wearing a shirt, they will either chase you or beat you even and go to report you to any of your parents, which is not the case nowadays. Be somebody's son or daughter, police, it's a police case. So what did your parents used to do, or what did people in your community used to do that kept you in a proper way?
Yeah, also I will not disagree from what my parents have said. Like you've just said, children of those days used to be community, they used to call them community children. The child is for the whole community. So if Tata X finds, let's say, a child of his doing something wrong, then definitely he or she will have to. Yeah, the same apply to me, because me, I grew up in an extended family where everyone is a father and everyone is a mother, irrespective of whether they are biological or not. So we grew up, you know, in that manner of fearing adults, you know, respect. You know, when someone tells you do this, you have to do it. Whether it's your father or not, you have to do it. It's a must. It's an adult, you have to respect. But now, just to try to bridge up the gap between now and then, people of the 60s will tell you a different story. Because for us, we are children of the 90s.
Yes.
You know, our upbringing is not that much different from the children of the 2000s. But if you compare from the ones in the 60s, if you bring here honorable so-and-so, will tell you, for us, none of them will not even let us to go to clubs. But now, these days, you can tell your man, I'm going out.
Yeah.
You know, and he or she will allow you to go out. But those days, how could you even go out? How? If they are here that you went out, that is an issue against drugs.
Yeah.
I'll just share about my experience. My father was a military man. And whenever he could come back home, everyone is happy. You know? And even if he would come to school, in boarding school, and they tell him that Tony is very stubborn, he'll actually slap the teacher. But the truth is, I was very stubborn. Very stubborn, and yet I was in. But because at home we used to be very humble, when it comes, respect is in the home. That is how we are raised. But not like today. Today a child can even, you know, argue with a parent.
Yes.
And say, no, that's not right. You know, and all that. Because that is the kind of setting, like, there's too much freedom. I'm not saying freedom shouldn't be there, but how these children are exercising this freedom. And the parents are taking it for granted. Like you say, parent comes back, they're on the laptop. Leave alone even the children themselves. Even the couples, the married ones. I've had so many times whereby someone is complaining that the other partner is always on the phone. When he or she comes back home, he's always on WhatsApp and not giving this. So the same applies. When the parents come back, they also do the same to the kids. And that is what the kids are seeing from their parents. So when they grow up, they'll do the same. How your parent has raised you is how you're going to raise your children. So if I was not the kind, the way I was raised is the same way I'm going to raise my child. Because the Maganda say that, what you see from, literally that's what you do. So now, because of we are in the 21st century, you know, things are just,
we have removed most of the things
exactly. So whatever the child is seeing is what they also do, and that is how they also live their own lives. So just to wrap it up in answering your question, to me, I think we have to go back to the basics. And you know, and command respect in our families. But because this is elementary, a child can disrespect anyone. I have an uncle. He has kids by the separated with the mother. You know, and I was very surprised the kid telling me that I don't know them. I only know my dad and my father. So, but this is an 8-year-old girl.
Yeah.
So that is the kind of, you know,
the society we are into now.
The society we are into. And you can't blame them for that is what their parents tell you.
Definitely, you know.
So, but not like those days. How could you say that?
Yeah, of course, people used to know everyone in the community.
How could you say that?
Then I wanted to bring in an aspect of these people who stay in a single room and they have around 5 kids in the house, or 3 or 4 or 5 kids in the house, and they are staying in a single room. Because we have seen that very many people who are raised, if you look at people who are raised in a ghetto, most of them won't face this to a teacher. Mr. Simpala, we have seen very many families who are staying in a single room and they have around 4 kids in the house. So the kids sleep down, let me say the parents are sleeping up on the bed. And time for having sex reaches, and these people are playing sex when the kids are down, hearing what about second place. Doesn't this drive these people to get themselves into also sexual activities?
I will not agree. In fact, it's at a given percentage.
Mm.
Because it depends on the parents.
Mm.
Parents carry out certain activities. We shall not say 100% whenever they engage into sexual activities, children will. It's in their parents who will know the weird hours of the day, of the night, knowing that at this given time, most probably this kid is quiet. And they will do it, and you never know. The only thing which will see which will show the child that maybe my parents have been engaging into sex for a while, is hearing that my mom is pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
I'll get you some.
Mm-hmm.
So then there's also that community who do not care,
mm-hmm.
especially to parents, if one partner engages into alcohol, to start it off at any time. As they said, our issues of respect. Parents. There are some parents who respect their children, but there are parents who will never respect their children and the partner. So, a young child will see a father abusing the mother, and the young child will begin saying sorry to the mother. Sorry, forgive that. What has happened? What have you done? I'm hearing this, which was not common during our days. And in fact, you realize that during even our days, you could not notice that your parent was engaging into sex with you, with a friend,
mm-hmm.
or I mean, mother and father, because mm-hmm. the only thing which could signal you out that they have been in sexual activities is knowing that they are going to give back.
Mm-hmm.
Then the mother will say, okay, this like that. And the way the mother could package it
mm-hmm.
could differ.
Mm-hmm.
But today, there is a lot of exposure.
Mm-hmm.
Kids will know. You not tell them that it's out of this. I remember a story about our days when we used to remove the teeth. Your parents was like, nah, I'm going to give the rat will take the tooth. But today they will ask where. Then some questions that you'll be off. You may not answer their questions. So I think we need to know that these parents, they are somewhat responsible. And they may get to know the appropriate time
mm-hmm.
of doing it, if especially when maybe their children are at school, the father may come in, or at night in the weird hours, knowing that no one is
hearing,
then there they will carry on. If that is impossible, they can book out a lodge, you know you can improvise.
It depends on how much you earn.
Yes.
That also comes in financial issues.
Yes, you can improvise. No, it's not. You see, that is a natural call. You can improvise and get to know that I know my kids are at a sign of respect.
Yeah, say,
no, I'm not doing it at home.
Mm.
Let me do it somewhere else.
Mm. Then let me get to Deborah. Do you think the society itself also contributes to these young people getting themselves into sexual activities? Let me see, look at the society whereby bars are everywhere. We see Slamarock, drinking points are everywhere. The community sometimes is always messed up. and you pass somewhere, you find somebody squeezing someone, the two parties, two different sex, are squeezing themselves onto a wall or trying to have sex, and this 15 or 14 year boy or girl is passing and he's also seeing this. And do you think also this drives young people to get themselves into sexual activities?
100% correct. Mm-hmm. I will evidently prove it. Mm. At some place I know there is a bar. Mm. The kids created holes into the walls. Mm. That bar, you know, these karaoke girls, they actually go to strip and they are paid and they strip naked. Mm. So that one, I don't hesitate about it because I have seen it. Society, community contributes 100%. Imagine kids creating holes into the bar because they know there is going to be something that will impress them. Mm. You know? So I think also the community has to do something about it.
Okay. When it comes to tonic, we are going to discuss about the peer influence. Then, like, there is sometime when, let me talk about, I spent most of my time when I was young, I spent most of my time in the boarding session. We used to boys discuss about girls discuss about boys, and boys mostly they discuss about sexual stuff when it comes to girls. Does this also influence young people to get themselves into sexual activities at an early age?
Yes. Now, I'll also just share my experience. When I was in Form 3, I remember that time when we used to have a conversation at night, right? And whereby we could find someone who's not so much active in dating girls at school, mm. and we start teasing them, you know, you're a fella, you're not doing well, yeah. better. The same applies, even because me, I was a prefect, I used to go to the girls' dormitory, you know, so to discuss boys, you know. So, in the girls' dormitory, they will discuss about a boy X, how the guy is nice, and blah, blah, how the guy puts it well, true? And all that. So, the same applies. Now, but for the guys' side, it is different. Because for us, we are talking about the sexual activity, how we are going to engage. One account, I will determine. But remember, the person speaking is even 15 years and all that, but already, he's already showing you signs that they're ready to engage in sexual activity. I remember how we used to do it. Like, we used to share, at some point we used to share with the guys who are in S5 and S6, and for them, a girl used to come in our dormitory. You'd ask me how. Now, as people go for preps, you know, this the guy makes a deal with the girl. He's like, okay, come at around 8 p.m. So the guy removes the bulk from the dormitory. So when people come back to, you know, sleep, switching ones. Now that is a sign that already there's someone. So everyone will be. I remember they are taken. So, everyone has had a timetable that today, man, you know, I have a visit. So, that's not the bubble, it's not going to be on. So, you can see how kids were social, like, you know, away from school. So, by the time they come back home, you don't know as a parent what is happening at school.
You know, it's an order that has been at school.
Exactly. That's why I would say coupling will never end in school. Kids are very
sure.
Lastly, is what I would want to say. We are trying to fix. I call upon the government to review like our policies. For example, the last year's is very good because it is basing on cultural values, you know, this country. But however, there are other issues that we feel that are not in this framework, that are not, you know, bring about. Because we are using this framework to keep this information to kids in schools on sexuality. Someone just today I was in a meeting and someone was saying that even if you have to talk about sex in my community,
Because it's a taboo. How do you talk about sex in a community? How do you talk about sex? When you talk about sex in a class, the kids will be excited.
They will be very attentive.
They will be very excited. Mm-hmm. I remember one time we went to rooms and we were giving out condoms and teaching them how to use them. But the moment we talked about sex, I'm telling you there are even some people who had missed lectures, but the moment when they heard that we were in their university, they came. So you can see how the, you know, kids are excited about it. So, like, to wrap up all that, what I think is we need to, you know, package the way we give information, then, like the IC material, you know, like how you do it here at the center. You don't bring out the real issue, but you package it in a way that a child will be able to read and understand, not to ask you more questions, just like Joachim was saying.
Yeah.
You know, package to make them understand and make it be part of life.
Then this question that I'm going to ask you, it's a yes or no question. Would you teach your 16-year-old son or daughter how to use a condom?
That is when the child is sexually active. But I will give them the information about sex, you know, such that they know that whether if I start it now, it will affect me.
So is it a yes or no?
Mine is a no.
Would you teach your 16-year-old son or daughter how to use a condom?
100% yes.
Mr. Sempala, would you teach your 16-year-old son or daughter how to use a condom?
Being a teacher, I've already taught many. But as you see, most of these things are in line with these are birth control methods. And according to the coverage in my social area of discipline, it works. To tell them that it's like this and give them the importance of
the right information around. Then, if my last to you, the teacher, what do you do for those girls who get pregnant when they're at school? Because I believe you always check pregnancy when they come to school, is it?
If we get one, she passes through a counseling session, of which I have no comment upon what comes out from that. But we send them to the counselor and they counsel them, and we will help them.
Would you say if a girl gets pregnant in school, she should stay in school up to when she do her last oral exams?
Circumstances depend, son.
Yeah.
It means when you say if the girl gets pregnant in school, it means she got pregnant in school exactly. But you know, we're dealing with the people who stay with maybe women who are off and on, holidays, back and holidays. So, to me, personally, some of these children are collateral damages. You may not be fair if a boy is the husband is a UCE student. So you should be fair to both sides. If the boy can continue with studies, the girl also should continue with
studies.
That is my personal idea. But I don't know according to the laws.
Okay. Then what do you think need to be done to stop young people from engaging sexual activities?
You cannot
you
stop
have only
them.
2 minutes.
You cannot stop them because it's a natural call.
Sure.
We just limit, reduce.
We have nothing to do.
You only encourage them to protect.
Protect
yes.
Girls?
Yes.
To negotiate for self-sex.
Exactly.
Do girls always negotiate for self-sex?
Not engaging, giving. You just tell them to abstain. It's the right statement.
Yes, we have been always telling these people to abstain. Then always tell you to abstain till when? The right person or the right time,
the right partner.
When you get the right partner, when did she, like sometimes because we have been very many girls have been victims of having sex and they have been become pregnant and they can't take care of the kids. Even the man or the boy who has made this girl pregnant can't even support him. So, to Mr. Tony, what do you think need to be done to stop the young people from engaging into an early sex?
Write information, talk about sex, tell them about sex, the dangers of sex when they're still early. And secondly, is to encourage them to remain in school. The role, that's why I call that the role of parents to mainly, you know, make these kids their friends, talk about sex in home, and tell them that the right to life is to have education. So if you don't keep in school, then you will have this and this. Thirdly, is to, you know, like, you know, we are living in a
We are very poor. Because Uganda is very poor. So you've heard that so many are early pregnancies. For example, I'll use Botanical District. Where we have some child marriages and all that. But we found that it's as a result of, you know, you talked about cultural issues, like, you know, if they see you started both in breast, they think you should get a man and get married. I remember this child is just 14 years old, so this child will drop out of school and will go get married. And the reason that the parent will give you, I don't have money to continue after school. So the end result is getting married. So I think we should empower parents, you know, we should empower parents economically, and this goes to the government. We should empower parents economically, not to think that girls should be like the whip, like a drive to get something. Because when they give these girls to get married to men, they're expecting something small like sugar and all that. So empowering communities economically, in terms of, let's say, farming, or they have something that get generating income, this will encourage them to, you know, to keep girls in schools and all that. So, to me, that wraps up the whole question.
Yes, Deborah, this to me, this is the last one to you. You a girl, like, you've been approached by very many marketing vendors, but riders, I'm saying, like, in your community. If that's ever, do you think that these border riders and also market vendors have contributed? They are one of the leading cause of these girls to engage themselves in the sexual activities.
As a counselor, I must say they have contributed perfectly well.
Go ahead. So, what do you think that need to be done to stop these people from engaging in sexual activities?
I think boda men need to be educated as well about these young girls. Because I know they have, how do they call them? Circles or what? They call them circles.
Yeah.
So I think we should also reach to them through their webinars, because they will not accept, they'll tell you they don't have time, they're always working. But if you get them into that part and tell them we have something little to share, because these are our children, you know. And give them that information. We tell them what they're supposed to know.
They're the children of the country. Mr. Simple, what is your last message to the viewers before we summarize?
My last message to the viewers, I tell the young people to have a stay and stay in school.
The other name is so hard to pronounce. Deborah. That one. Your last message to the viewers.
My last message to the viewers, especially to the teens, our children, abstain, yes, and keep in school. Thank you.
Tony Mzira, what is your last message to the viewers, you as an advocate?
Yeah.
You have 1 minute.
One is to, I encourage that let's give these kids the right information. And parents, please, make these kids your friends. About this thing, you know, sex. One thing I can assure the viewers out there that the only person who came into this world is Jesus without sex. So if you can prove to me that there's someone who came into this world without sex, then that should be surrogation. But however, I would say, let's talk about this thing because they are part of life. You know, let's just try to package it because these kids are too sharp. They will go and look for that information. So you, as a parent, talk to these kids. They'll get there and they'll make the right decision when you give them the right information as a parent. Make them your friends. Secondly, I would say, let's keep the fire burning. Let's talk about these things. Let's talk about sexual reproductive health as something as food, you know, to the entire community, to the parents, to the religious leaders, to the kids themselves in our communities, to get to know about this. This is not something very bad. You know, people think when they talk about issues of sex, we are trying to spoil the world and all that, but the truth is, the reality is, these things are happening and
definitely.
It's a basic need.
It is our role to make sure that we actually, you know, solve these issues by ourselves. No one will solve them. So nothing without us, without us.
And then,
for me, my last message is make sure, like they have said, they are also keep in school, abstain from sex. You'll have sex or play sex with whoever you want after you having your education. Remember, like, few men will like you if you are not empowered or if you don't have enough money. And sell them to the men. Few girls want poor people. Yes, love is there and feeling is there, but people will love poor people. Make your money, go study, work hard, look for money. Don't think of sex. You have sex with whatever you want, anytime that you want. Remember, SKS was brought to you by Nagui Fefe Network, and also we are located at China Uganda French Hospital. We have different services. Remember, you can also either watch and watch our shows on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. We are always there. On Facebook, you can look for S Class. Then on Twitter, you can look for S Class 256. Then on YouTube, you can also look for S Class 256. And also on Instagram, you can look for S Class 2. Remember, we are always here to serve you every time that we get. Keep on the page, we shall always tell what is coming up next. Be part of the conversation, drop your comments, drop your reactions, share the page, tell a friend to your friend that S Class is there to educate young people and also share the views of the young people when it comes. We are all going to go in communities and in schools where we have views or reactions from young people. Thank you so much. See you till next time.